The brain is a dynamic, complex organ that controls thought, memory, emotion, touch, and every process that regulates our bodies. Neuroimaging technologies allow us to examine the brain structure and function of living humans, offering tremendous insights into how the brain differs between healthy people and disease patients. In this video, we will review various neuroimaging techniques that provide data about brain structure and function, and we'll discuss some methods for analyzing that data. After watching this video, you should be able to differentiate structural MRI from functional MRI, explain the basic steps for analyzing fMRI scans, describe the purpose of applying statistical models or machine learning to neuroimaging data, discuss possible paths toward becoming an expert in neuroimaging analytics.
Neuroimaging, broadly speaking, refers to series of methods or approaches or techniques that would allow scientists to look at how different regions of brain work or interact with each other through capturing their representation or graphically capturing their images. Basically, it's like a motion picture variation of how the brain reacts to external stimuli.
I think one of the most fascinating things about neuroimaging is its dependency on multiple disciplines. So we need to understand a little bit about neuroscience, or biology, if you will. We need to understand a little bit about the physics that allows us to capture these images. And we need to understand a little bit about the mathematics that allow us to analyze these images.
So I was introduced to neuroimaging when I actually got accepted into a program that dealt with data science. So I was given the opportunity to create an interactive web page that looks at the brain. I utilized code to be able to look at the brain. I was able to tilt the brain around and look more into the lenticulous triad arteries. So I had a lot of fun with the coding aspect, and everything was brand new to me. I didn't know a lot about neuroimaging. I'm more into the stats a part of it, so it was a great experience.
The most common types of neuroimaging are magnetic resonance imaging, or MRI, as well as the functional aspect of MRI called fMRI. And there is the use of computed tomography, which has been around for over 100 years. Through techniques like magnetic resonance imaging, or MRI, we are able to image the aging brain without opening the head, which was necessary up to the advent of techniques like that.
MRI scanners use strong magnetic fields and radio frequency waves to generate images of the organs in the body, including the brain. Structural MRI of the brain shows brain anatomy. Compared with other neuroimaging techniques, structural MRI offers better image resolution and better contrast between gray and white matter. The detailed images that result make structural MRI an ideal choice for studying the brain and gaining more information about conditions of the central nervous system, such as Alzheimer's disease and related dementias. In addition to creating pictures of brain anatomy, MRI can show how the brain responds to different stimuli and how parts of the brain are connected to each other, enabling researchers to study brain function and connectivity as well as structure.
Functional magnetic resonance imaging, or fMRI, which works based on building a magnetic field and capturing the brain activity, is the most sort of efficient way of imaging, which in a sense allows for creating 3D movies from the brain.
The primary form of fMRI is blood oxygen level dependent, BOLD, imaging, discovered by C.G. Ogawa in 1990. BOLD imaging allows researchers to observe changes in oxygenated blood flow to different brain regions over time. Because blood flow to different areas of the brain occurs when those areas are active, this technique allows researchers to view what parts of the brain activate together at rest and how different brain regions respond to various stimuli. Complex statistical contrasts are applied to the images after certain analysis steps have been completed. The results, indicating changes in oxygenated blood over time, are color-coded and superimposed on top of the brain image to indicate spatially specific effects. In this section, we learned that there are multiple ways to record and study the human brain, including MRI and fMRI. Structural MRI is used to show brain structures, while fMRI shows functional changes over time within the brain.
Modern technology allows for capturing brain activity in a three-dimensional space. The units of MRI, thereby, are these things called voxels. You can think of them as tiny little cubes that capture X, Y, and Z axes of the three-dimensional space. Each single one of those voxels thereby contain information of a certain part of the brain that was the subject of that fMRI recording.
fMRI scans are made up of many images of the entire brain acquired at set time points throughout the scan session. At each fMRI time point, the scanner collects a full brain image that is composed of many voxels. Researchers can evaluate how fMRI signal changes at each of the voxels in the brain image over time. The resolution of an image is determined by the number of voxels included within a particular scan area.
So if we think of a movie as a bunch of frames that are being put together, a bunch of snapshots that once you line them up, you have a motion picture, then this MRI functionality would allow us to capture very, very precise frames, single frames, of the position or activity of a brain at any given time.
In this section, we learned that voxels are small three-dimensional units that make up an MRI scan. fMRI is made up of many images of the entire brain taken at set time points throughout the scan session. At each fMRI time point, the scanner acquires a full brain image that is composed of many voxels. When images collected at different fMRI time points are lined up, they result in a 3D movie of the brain, and changes at each voxel over time can be evaluated. Neuroimaging signal is meaningful information that represents what a researcher is trying to measure. In fMRI, signal would represent changes in oxygenated blood in response to brain activity. Noise is the unwanted interference, such as from instability in the magnetic field or head motion, that makes the true signal harder to detect. Before fMRI scans can be used, they will need to go through a pre-processing stage. The goal of pre-processing fMRI images is to reduce noise, making true signal easier to detect. One fMRI pre-processing step is to correct for head motion that is likely to occur during an fMRI scanning session. This correction is done mainly by realigning the separate brain images collected across scan time points for a single study participant. The image from each time point is aligned to an image collected for that same person at a single time point.
Data pre-processing predominantly deals with removing noise from data. No data is 100% accurate all the time because there are all sorts of physical and natural processes that can clutter data, that can add noise to data.
In MRI, for example, patients do not sit still in the scanner, and that results in motion artifact, and that can blur images to the extent that they are difficult to use. So one of the sets of techniques that we use in image processing of MRIs refers to artifact reduction so that we can recover the quality of the images to the extent that we can process them according to our algorithms.
Statistical analysis of fMRI data is performed in multiple stages. In the first stage, the goal is to evaluate how changes over time in the information at each voxel relate to changes over time in a variable of interest. This is an example of statistical modeling across space and time, or spatiotemporal modeling. For instance, the experimenter may compare the time course of activity at each voxel to the timing of a series of intermittent tasks and rest periods presented to the participant while that person is being scanned. This analysis helps to identify which voxels have activity that is correlated with the task. The second stage of analysis deals with identifying how effects differ between study participants. For instance, an experimenter may evaluate whether the brain regions associated with the task are different between people with the disease and healthy controls. In this section, we learned that before fMRI data can be used for analysis, it must undergo pre-processing, such as correction for head motion. Pre-processing of fMRI data reduces unwanted noise, making true signal easier to detect. fMRI changes at each voxel over time are compared with the time course of a variable of interest, such as a task. Differences in the relationship between the time course of signal at each voxel and the time course of a variable of interest are then evaluated among study participants based on a characteristic of interest. Statistical modeling relates different factors, such as disease diagnosis or risk factors, to variations across subjects in a brain measure, such as the size of a brain structure or the signal in functional MRI voxels. This helps researchers to determine whether the relationships they see are stronger than they would be likely seen by chance. One example of statistical modeling is the general linear model.
For example, if we are interested in measuring white matter integrity as a function of age, but we're acquiring data from both males and females, we may want to remove the confounding effect of sex. And so that can be done in a general linear model. One of the greatest strengths of the general linear model is that it provides us with a way to model brain activity and brain structure in a very general way that is very well understood by statisticians. And because most phenomena in the brain and in neuroscience can be modeled using this kind of approach, it's a very versatile way to analyze brain data.
Machine learning is a type of artificial intelligence. It refers to certain analytic approaches for fitting models to data. The model gradually learns as the algorithms of machine learning are implemented. For instance, machine learning models could be trained to identify what features of brain images and other data, such as personal characteristics or exposure to risk factors, best predict who will develop a particular disease in the near future.
Machine learning is a branch of data science, computer science, I would argue statistics, that is a byproduct of artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence, or AI, refers to methods, systems, ideas, approaches that tries to build an intelligent system or a model or an engine that helps with that decision-making process that lies at the heart of data analysis.
In this section, we discussed statistical and machine learning methods can relate characteristics of study participants to brain measures of interest. They can also help identify factors associated with diseases that affect the brain.
I would encourage our students to think about ways that they can learn enough broad and introductory knowledge about statistics, computing, and biology, so that that knowledge can guide their future wherever their interest lies to pursue that.
Someone with a background in math or computer science or biophysics might be interested in joining neuroimaging as a researcher in ways that leverage their skills from the standpoint of analytics and developing new methods for analyzing brain images.
And so in the end, I chose the research that I was more passionate about because I figured if I really like the research, I'll be willing to put more of the work and the effort into it. And also to students, to don't be afraid to ask questions. Don't be afraid to get out of your comfort zone, because when I started, I didn't know a lot about neuroimaging. And just putting myself out there, I really learned a lot. And in the end, I came out with some really great insights.
I encourage students to find where one of these methods resonate with their interests more, and then, you know, actively pursue that. But obviously, learning about the foundations or basic infrastructure knowledge in all these areas would be extraordinarily helpful.
Neuroimaging allows us not only to try and understand what makes us human, how do we think, how are our thoughts organized even, or how is the brain organized? But it also gives us an opportunity to look at some of the most devastating diseases that affect the human condition. Those are diseases of the human brain. And I have to say that if you look at modern medicine, if you look at the degree of successes that we've had in corralling other diseases, maybe of the heart or cancers, we've made enormous progress. It's been really quite revolutionary. But that's not true in brain. Most diseases of the brain still challenge us. They remain an enigma in terms of how they affect the brain, why they affect the brain, and how you can control them. Whether they're neurological diseases or psychiatric disorders, this is a great frontier for us. We have to meet the challenge of diseases of the brain.